Dubey, the Vice Chancellor of Dr. C.V. Raman University. Myself, Dr. Jawahar Surisetty, Kiran Pal Singh Chawla, Chairman of Career Point World School. Dr. Satyajit Hota is the Principal of Alliance Public School. Jayashree Nair is the Principal of Brighton International School, Raipur. And we have Dr. Ravi Gupta, Founder and CEO of ELETS Technomedia. So a very high-powered panel it is. I hope to do justice to this panel because it's difficult to handle a high-powered panel. National Education Policy, I will not call it New Education Policy because it's no more new. NEP, as an opening comment I am making, and then we'll open it to the thing. I was a part of this discussions. So there are three major issues that are characteristic of this NEP. The first is that in the world of policy making, this document is one of the most researched, one of the most sought after document, because the government took almost 4 to 5 years to come up with this and then approve it. And it also put it to the all the stakeholders. So there were discussions in students. CBSC sent circulars to the students, teachers, principals. Universities had discussions within themselves. Then gram panchayats had discussions before they sent in their requests of change in whatever parts of the policy that they wanted. So it was a very comprehensive policy making process that the government followed, with all stakeholders participating. The first thing. The second thing is that the first time policy is usually made around the government or the teaching community. This is the first time that we are seeing that the child or young boy or the student is the center of this policy. So everything that has been thought after is in this policy is only based on the student. So we can call it a filiocentric policy. And the third and most important thing that I feel is that the government itself has come up and said that no, it's almost like saying that we have done these things wrong and we want to correct it, which usually no government says. So in a policy making, these the three characteristics that we see in NEP are milestones in themselves in the policy making of any policy in the government, especially of the central government that I have seen. So I'll go to Dr. Satyajit Hota meanwhile. Dr. Hota is from Alliance Public School, Bemetra. Dr. Hota, can you unmute yourself first? Yes. So how do you find the new education policy, and what are the opportunities that you see in this?
Namaste.
Namaskar.
My salutation to all the great educators, today's panel, and all the beloved of education. Where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habits. In that moment, the spotlight we are putting over the new education policy draft. It's really our fortune that we have get this chance to express our feelings, express our analytical viewpoint in front of all of you. My dear, that education policy, first we have to understand that it is not the legal or constitutional document. It consists of number of principles and government policies in the edu arena of the country as the global spectrum focus. Collecting of rules, laws, which governed by the operation of education. If you'll go and see its evolution, then it has started from 1948 49 in the University Educational Commission. After that, 1952. Then we are coming to 1964-65, where Educational Commissions by Dr. D.S. Kotharishar, first National Education Policy, 1968, passed by the Parliament. Then 42nd Constitutional Amendment has taken place in 1976. And second, our NEP, that is Educational Concurrent List, that is in 1986. And in 2016, Committee for the Great Evolutions of National Educational Policy, under the chairmanship of our late TSR Subramanian, has submitted. And today we have got the present new educational policy, which is led by Dr. K. Kosturi Rangan and submitted on May 31st, 2019, 480 pages. After that, filtration has occurred and we have come and we have got this by the consolidated of 54 pages documents. In this regards, I want to say very important changes which we have observed, that the recognitions of education first time means HRD ministry now renamed as Ministry of Education. That is the recognitions which education was striving for since more than 34 years. GDP investment, 1.6 to 6%. It is also one of the excellency, and focusing on gross enrollment ratio, it will be increased to 50% by 2035. So now it's very important for us that there are 10 points which I can share with all of you. That is the RET, where I felt very much happy because I am from a middle class family, and that to be lower middle class. So when I am watching about the RET illustrated, the spreading, it was earlier 6 to 14 years, and now it has extended from 3 years to 14 years. Here, I am also giving thanks that midday meal has added with the breakfast for our people of the rural and countryside of the country. And reductions of the dropout, the missions. And the most important, that is ECCE, very clearly defined. All students should get equal opportunity. School complex has illustrated separate teachers training and pooling mechanisms. The visions is very, very effective here. And the most important, that is the Siksha recruitment. Siksha recruitment, where we are watching the para teachers, then Siksha Mitra and guest teachers, these are the abolishment, and a new continuous service oriented teachers will be joined, who will dedicate for the educational arena or business of the education. Directorate of Education, which was totally centralized, now it is in different form. So the medium of, so it is in different form for the regulation, operations, and upliftment. The different directorate has formed, different channel has developed. And the most chaotic situation in every day we are watching, that is the medium of instruction. Hey, so, the dear educationist, when we are talking about the medium of instructions, and that is the three language formula has applied from the very beginnings, from our great Lakshmanji educational society, still today we are going for this three language system. So nothing is new for it in this new educational policy. Here, the instruction, we have to be very much clear for the social educationist that
sir,
the instruction
sir, Mr.
of
Mr. Hota,
yeah, please
we
sir.
We will discuss this later. So this language thing is a very important thing. We'll have a separate discussion on this.
Okay.
Dr. Okay. R.P. Dubey, are we able to get you here? Dr. Dubey? Dr. Dubey, are you there? No. Mr. Kiran Pal Singh Chawla is there. Hello, sir. How are you? Unmute yourself. Yes. No, I'm not able to hear you, sir. I'll come back to you, sir, later. Jayashree Nair, ma'am, from the principal of Brighton International School. Ma'am, could you unmute yourself?
Yes, sir. I can hear you.
Yeah. Very, very, very. We are able to hear you. Before I go to you, ma'am.
Yeah.
I would request all panelists to maintain the time. One is that let's not enumerate what the NEP has said because most of us know. As the panelists, we know. So we will discuss threadbare the points that we are questioning. And based on your understanding, you will throw in, I think, very valuable inputs on these points. So let's stick to the timeline because everybody has to speak.
Sure.
Ma'am, so you look at NEP and what it has created for the students. But can you see any challenges that as of now the NEP possesses before it goes and becomes an act?
Yes. I find there are certain challenges, sir. Though it will end up the India shadow education system, that is the tuition and all, but yet it will have the teething problem initially. Research and development is one of the things which has been stated by the government that every sector, every school has to go through. But for research and development, government needs a good infrastructure and efficient teachers, efficient laboratories to conduct it. So we cannot look into it that tomorrow we can start it with the system. It will take its own time. There are certain things, as the government said, that rote learning will be abolished. Accepted. Very good. Fantastic. Rote learning should be abolished. But at the same time, when the children will be doing the things like mathematics, science, and statistics or economics, especially national income kind of things, they require complete attention of the teacher. As per the national ratio of teacher student, it is 16:1, but we are nowhere near it. We still are having with 30:1, and the tuitions which the government wants to put an end to will definitely only come to an end when we have experienced excellent teachers and the ratio moves to 16:1. Otherwise, the tuitions will never come to an end. Conceptual education, agreed, fantastic it is. But accordingly, it needs to open with the various arenas in for the students where they can compete with different people. And a project-oriented learning should take place so that they should put their credibility into it and show that yes, they are capable enough of doing it. As it is being said that critical thinking and experimentation will take place, definitely we will get a workforce if this education policy is being introduced and get into focus. Definitely we will have students, we will have a workforce which will be able to appreciate, which will be able to learn that how to synthesize and abstract information and other things can be involved and developed. Similarly, virtual learning needs to take place. So as per the current scenario, there are villages which don't have schools, where electricity is not possible. In that condition, how the government is going to face all this situation and what are the outcomes that government will take place of? No doubt it's not impossible, but it's a bit difficult. When we can reach to Andaman and Nicobar Islands with the 4G system, we can reach to any corner of India with 4G system. But the government will is the most important thing. Thank you, sir.
Very well put, Jayashree ma'am. It was very crisp very. It's a well researched points that you have put forward. Dr. Dubey, am I able to hear? Are you able to hear me?
Sir.
मुझे आपकी आवाज आ रही है.
हेलो,
मुझे आपकी आवाज आ रही है.
Am I heard?
I am able to hear you. Yes, yes. Yes, sir.
नमस्कार.
आप आप अकेले आर यू एबल टू हियर मी? आपको मेरी आवाज आ रही है? अच्छा, ओके. आप अकेले हैं पैनल में हैं जो हायर एजुकेशन के हैं सर, तो आपका रोल बहुत जरूरी है. हाँ, तो बेस एनईपी का जो रोल है इन हायर एजुकेशन. हेलो,
आ रही है ना?
आपको आवाज आ रही है? हाँ हाँ, आपकी आ रही है. तो एनईपी का रोल जो हायर एजुकेशन में है, वो उसके बारे में थोड़ा सा, हाउ डू यू सी इट, रोल ऑफ एनईपी इन हायर एजुकेशन. नहीं आ रही आवाज? अभिषेक, कैन यू लुक इनटू इट? हाँ, मीनवाइल आई विल टेक मिस्टर किरण पाल सिंह चावला.
यस सर.
अभिषेक देखो ना एक बार. Mr. Chawla, are you there? Are you able to?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am very much here, and a very warm good morning to all the esteemed panelists and Dr. Jawahar Suri Shetty. It's a pleasure hearing you. Thank you so much. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, sir. So, any initial thoughts on the NEP that you have?
Sir, from the fraternity that I come from, the school education part, I am really delighted with the whole idea of the new NEP 2020. That it is actually going to revolutionize the whole education system. But as rightly everybody has their own doubts, what I have gone through is that after a period of almost 34 years, such a document has come. And the quick point that I would like to highlight is that there were like preschools which had mushroomed in every nook and corner of the city with absolutely no framework or curriculum available to them. So this NEP now bringing in into education, the 5+3+4+4 system, so that early childhood education would also be like properly oriented and decided. And as it is rightly said, that the major development of the brain happens in the early 6 to 8 years. And a child, when he comes to class first, coming from very lowly preschools or something, he struggles in class 1 or 2 in premium schools. So with this new NEP, every child, wherever he is, will be governed by a curriculum. He'll be reading a curriculum, and he will be at par with any other student who is like more blessed or more lucky to get good early childhood education. So that is something, one thing that I see. And the second thing that I really see is that we'll be having at least 10 bagless days for the students now. So for at least 10 days, the students will be bagless. And one thing very close to my heart, Dr. Suri, I would like to mention is, कि भारत देश में एक सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज था कि श्रम का सम्मान नहीं था. There was not dignity of labor. So now when our children will be introduced to vocational classes right from class 6 onwards, at least and whenever they will be able to spend some 10 close days with these mentors who will be into the vocational experts, slowly and gradually that dignity of labor and श्रम का सम्मान आएगा, wherein this unemployment issues. Today, a child from a farmer background doesn't want to go back to the fields and do tilling of the land. So such practices over a period of time will come down, and our children will be more open to take up all the kind of jobs with equal dignity and with equal respect. And that is how what Narendra Modi ji is saying is Atmanirbhar Bharat. Or somebody is suggesting pakode talo, somebody is suggesting gobar uthao. So what are all these things? They are actually making children self-sufficient in some or the other way. So this new education policy is really, really going to be a big milestone in the history of India again. That's my take.
Yes, sir. So, am I able to get Mr. Dubey still or not? Hello, Abhishek? Is he available?
Dubey sir is trying to connect through his laptop. Actually, he is right now on the mobile.
Okay, so we'll continue. Anybody else who is left with us? Mr. Ravi Gupta is there online, I suppose.
So Ravi Gupta sir is will join soon, sir. Right now
okay,
we have to.
No, not an issue. Okay. So let's go back to Jayashree ma'am, who had raised some issues on the rote learning in maths ratio of teachers to students, tuitions. How do we stop tuitions? Critical thinking workforce. Villages without electricity. Meanwhile, I think Dr. R.P. Dubey is here. Sir, are you there? Dubey sir, आपको मेरी आवाज आ रही है?
नहीं, I think he is not able to get our voice, sir.
Okay.
I will just cross check with him.
Okay. Jayashree ma'am, so am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. So suppose you are on board of this policy, policy making. So the rote learning that you say that is required to some extent in mathematics. How do you wish to solve it?
I said that is a challenge. Conceptual learning should be the most important thing to happen. Numeracy and language. I have one more concern about it. As per the mother tongue has to be used for learning in the earlier stages. I have one question that how it will be managed after class 5? Because after class 5, the children will go, or the higher education should always be in the mother tongue only. Till whatever stage they study, it should be in mother tongue.
So are you saying that if the three language policy that they have said, one is the mother tongue, one is the local language, and one is the national language. So are you saying that if till fifth somebody has learned, let's say in Chhattisgarh, they have learned in Hindi, then they should continue in Hindi till 12th? Are you saying this?
Yes. Because
you're saying this.
Yeah, because expression becomes a big issue there. You just think about a child who has learned up to class. I have seen these kind of children. That's why I'm sure about it. It becomes very difficult. It becomes a challenge. We had children in our school from this Jawahar Yojana. And they were excellent students up to class 5. They were the toppers of their district who came to our school to join in class 6. And we found that the poor fellows were struggling. And they managed it. I won't say they didn't manage. But it took a little time. It took a year or so to meet or come at par with the others. Still, expression was a big issue with them. So I think language, whatever is chosen from the beginning, should go till the higher education.
Okay. So you again, I am putting the same question to Mr. Kiranpal Singh Chawla.
Yes, sir.
Sir, do you agree with what Mrs. Jayashree is saying?
See, I certainly agree with Jayashree madam what she is saying, but I see two challenges over here. Mm-hmm. One thing is that we are comparing ourselves with the countries like China and with the countries like France and Spain, wherein their mother languages are Chinese or French or Spanish. Now, in India, the thing is that for all these years, English has been a language which has been an international language and which has also been a developed language in India that has been a USP also for the Indian working force. Now, if the challenge is, if they say that the children will be studying in their local languages, my concern or the question that I have over here is that supposedly a child is studying in the local language till class 5th, as madam said, that Jawahar Utkarsh Yojana she quoted of, wherein children are being given to the schools after class 6, wherein they have to study the CBSE syllabus and that too all in English and in premium schools. So these children really get a great beating on their self-confidence part of it. So we have to have such a thing that Hindi is very good, कि अगर आप हिंदी में बच्चे को 12th तक पढ़ाना चाहते हैं तो फिर उसके बाद पूरा का पूरा फ्रेमवर्क आप हिंदी प्रो हिंदी बनाइए फिर सारी कहीं पर भी ये डिमार्केशन ना हो या कोई एनालिसिस ना हो कि जिस बच्चे को इंग्लिश अच्छी नहीं आती उस बच्चे का आपने कॉन्फिडेंस लूज हो गया, वो बच्चा आपके साथ कम्पीट नहीं कर पा रहा है बाकी किसी एग्जाम्स में, और जिन स्कूलों में या जिन स्टेट्स में आई वुड से लाइक सदर्न स्टेट्स विल बी लाइक हैविंग मोर एडवांटेज इनकेस अगर उनको वहां पर इंग्लिश लैंग्वेज ही प्राइमरी लैंग्वेज के रूप में मिलती है तो ये एक चैलेंज रहने वाला है एंड इट्स अ फार ड्रीम। ये okay. दो चीजों को गैप कैसे करेंगे ये देखने की बात होगी।
नहीं मैं आयरोनिकली जब पहला आइट्रेशन ऑफ द ड्राफ्ट वाज मेड और सबसे जब फीडबैक मंगाए गए थे तो तमिलनाडु हैड रेज दिस ऑब्जेक्शन दैट इंग्लिश शुड बी अ मीडियम ऑफ इंस्ट्रक्शन, इंग्लिश इज देयर एज अ लैंग्वेज नाउ बट नॉट एज अ मीडियम ऑफ इंस्ट्रक्शन, सो दे हैड रेज दिस इशू सर। बट कमिंग फ्रॉम अ बैकग्राउंड दैट आई कम फ्रॉम वेयर forget about English, I have not been to school. अगर मुझे opportunity मिलती है कि मैं English सीख सकूं and I have learnt it on my own, तो why not we think that these children, even if it's from sixth standard, they get an opportunity to learn English, why is it so difficult?
Sir, actually आपका कहना बिल्कुल सही है कि there are not only you, there are so many learned people who have been studying in government schools and today they are all big, nicely placed in the bureaucracy and all across the fraternity. That is certainly true. But the overall framework that I am saying, that's, that parents' mindset has to change, yes. That society's mindset has to change, that the parents should understand that it is a language. And I perfectly agree ki aaj ghar pe agar hum Hindi aur Punjabi bolte hain, to mere bachche ko mujhe English mein uske question puchne ke baad kehna padta hai ki achha mujhe ab Hindi mein samjhao. कि तुमने समझा कि नहीं।
इसका कारण है सर, इसका कारण है कि मैं लोकल लैंग्वेज या हिंदी में सोचता हूँ, लेकिन मेरा पेरेंट, हाँ, मेरा पेरेंट एक्सपेक्ट करता है कि मैं बोलूं इंग्लिश में जबकि मेरी सोच हिंदी में है या व्हाटएवर लोकल लैंग्वेज इज देयर। आई थिंक देयर इज यस, तो चाइना वाइना में यही होता है कि दे थिंक एंड स्पीक इन द सेम लैंग्वेज, सो एनीवे वी आर नॉट कंपेयरिंग दैट। And I am also not a great supporter of not having English, but just for the sake of a debate and a better understanding, we are doing it. So, is Mr. Dubey available right now? The higher education part is still missing.
Not there, sir.
नहीं आया क्या?
He is not there.
He is not. So, what I will do is the higher education segment, which is missing from our debate right now, I will take up that segment. So, in the higher education segment, we've had some fantastic. Continuous learning things. Dr. Dubey has come. Sir, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, हम लोग miss कर रहे थे, higher education को miss कर रहे थे.
Yeah.
अच्छा. NEP में सर, NEP में हाँ आपको क्या लगता है कि अच्छा है और
सर
और बहुत अच्छा नहीं है? What is good in NEP and what is not so good?
फिर से कट रही है सर आवाज।
अच्छा, क्या अच्छा है क्या अच्छा नहीं है सर? No? No, 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 no. ठीक है सर, आपकी आवाज आ रही है हमको? We are not able to.
Hello.
Can you mute him? Yeah. No, sir, not able to hear you. Okay. So, so let's go to the segment of higher education. So a few points which the school education representatives in the panel can elaborate whether it is in line with what they are thinking or not. Because you are the feeders for the colleges and universities. So one thing is that they have tried and internationalized the degree system, because Indian students who did their BBA, BSc, BA, BBA of 3 years were not allowed to do their masters in the US because it's a 12+4 system. So now what they have come up with is a 4-year degree. The second thing what they have done is that any exit of students, suppose I join engineering because my parents wanted me to join, and after the first year I feel no, I am not fit for engineering, I leave first year of engineering, after first year of engineering, and then go to another thing like BSc, BBA, whatever, I lose a year. So the first year, now they are giving a certificate, second year diploma, third year degree, and fourth year degree with research is what they have proposed. And it's a good thing because all exits, it's like a freeway or a national highway where to go to a particular village, you have to get out of the highway. So it's a good thing, and those credits can be transferred to another degree, which is a very good thing that has happened. After the fourth year degree, you can directly go for research, or after the third year, you can go for a 2 years master's. If you go for a master's after the fourth year, then it's only for 1 year. This is one important aspect. The second important aspect that they have said is the three modes of BEd, teacher training. The first is that there is a 4 year BEd after 12th. Then there is a 2 year BEd after the 3 year degree course, and 1 year BEd after the 4 year degree course. This is another thing. The third and most important thing is they have said that by 2030, we will have one university in every district of India. And how they have approached it is a very practical way. Any college which has more than 3,000 students will be converted into a university. So any college which meets the necessary quality criteria and which has more than 3,000 students will be converted into a university. So that means that any college in a district which has more than 3,000 students is likely to become a university. So that's the good point, that they want to reach out and promote research by through the National Research Foundation is something that they have set out in the higher education thing. Anything from this, Mr. Hota, I am coming to you. Anything from the higher education segment which you think does not sync with the school education policy? Mr. Hota.
Sir, you have told a very nice point that it is encouraging the students for the multi-dimensional expressions through their certificate, diploma, and degree courses with their graduational levels. It's really excellent thing has done. But here one question just I'm asking actually to the whole panel, that how it will be possible for the, in the essence of liberalization of education, in the essence of liberalization of education, we should not volatile the core content of our subject material. This is the fear of the educational world. In this regards, I want that what will be our pathway? Because for the, at the sense of applications, if we will lose our core content, because already we are minimized here. So the core content, if it will be much more minimized there, and we will focus only for the integrational as well as collaborative learning methodology and experimental way, then somewhere we will miss our own DNA, core content of the subject.
Okay, sir, there is a thought process that has gone into the policy, and when they have said this, I can understand what you are saying and I can understand your pain point. But the thought process that has gone in is something like this. I am giving an example. Suppose there is an IAS officer. He goes through the civil services exam and he takes one subject, let's say history or geography or whatever subject. And maybe he is an expert in that. And then he gives the exam and qualifies. Where is the test of leadership skills? Where is the test of collaboration? Where is the test of coordination? So the committee feels that the minimum basic education that we can give should be given in the form of content of that subject, but also add to it a lot of life skills, because CII and FICCI, the two industry bodies, have said that we find only 25% of young boys and girls graduates who are employable. The reason is they have all the content, they have all the subject matter, but they are still not fit for employment in the industry. Why? So if we argue that the content should not be diluted, then what are the other skills that which we are currently giving in the form of subjects? What are the skills that they are lacking that the industry is still not finding them fit, is something that the new education policy is trying to address. And this is the understanding that I get. If you still want to argue on this, we'll argue on this. But there must be a point of discussion that you are making. But the understanding of the committee was this. And that is the reason they have tried and minimized the except the conceptual part, they have minimized the content of subjective knowledge, is the understanding that I have.
Another thing again, it's creating fear among all of us.
Okay.
That one side we are saying that commercializations should be minimized. Okay. And they are talking, sir, in this place, we have a question actually. this policy, which actually they have told about the minimization of commercialization, one side we are opening our whole business for the outside best universities, let them come and join with us. And another side, they are saying that we will go for to set up the campus in outside of the country. So it is in my mind actually that just like this China, now we are saying that China has captured our all industrial sectors and we are not able to develop the articles as the China wants. Then how it will be possible actually if we will call them? Earlier there was a time when Takshila, Sila, Nalanda and everywhere our universities were there and the peoples were coming from far, far away. And now they are coming with their institution and we are the learner. So is it not again opening the commercializations?
Okay. Another so yes, sir, very valid question. But are we not to blame for this? That if there was Nalanda existing in India and today the leadership of higher education and research has gone to some other places and we learn from them, are we not to blame? Are our teachers not to blame? Are our school, colleges, universities not to blame? We should take the blame also. And if we stop universities from abroad, the top 100, if you say, that means they have gained some name and fame due to whatever they have done in the past. And that is why they are in the top 100. So if they come inside, this is like George Fernandez long back saying that Coca-Cola should not come to India. Today, Coca-Cola is there. We have an equivalent brand which was threatening Coca-Cola, which was Thumbs Up. And Coca-Cola had to ultimately buy it out. So if we are strong in our foothold, these universities will not be able to do anything. But the secondary thing is, almost all the top 100 universities have entered into partnerships with the big corporate houses in India and with a twinning program like UCLA has come up. University of California, Los Angeles is in India already with Great Lakes. Then Georgia Tech is there with Bennett University. Then Imperial College London is there with BML Munjal. So they are already here. There is nothing that this policy does except for formalizing it. First point. The second point is that we should have equal opportunity for our good universities and colleges to go abroad. So it is like export-import. If I am exporting and I am also importing, nothing wrong in it. It's only wrong if we are completely importing. So if I am only bringing in 100 universities and not letting my universities set up their campuses, the good ones set up campuses there, this is equal opportunity. This is reaching out to the world and saying that India is also there. This is the positive side of the policy part that you are making a reference to. Hota sir, I'll come back to you on this. Let me also bring in Jayashree ma'am, is there something?
Because actually we had gone through this draft nicely. I had gone line by line, but here it is not at all explained that how we will fill up the gap. That is the whole problem. How we will fill up the gap? Now, if you will see the rank of our even IIT, IIM with other institutions of the world, then where we are standing? So when will reach to the gap or when will fill up the gap and what will be the way out of it? Just like one just small example I'm giving you, ECCE program they are giving with Anganwadi, preschools and your that Bal Batika. Will they able to complete with the DPS or excellent school of the country, pre-primary level? So sir, who will fill up the gap, sir?
No. We are talking of two different things. ECCE is a school education. We are talking of higher education. Anyway,
in higher education also, the same way I am talking.
No, I am answering the ECCE
rank,
also.
Rank,
sir,
yeah.
ECCE also I am answering. How many DPS do you have? 200, 250,
300? Elite schools I am talking about.
Sir, 70% of the country's school education is with the government sector. Because they are able to reach to every nook and corner. So I am saying the policy should not be looked at only, you should look, but don't look it only from the private school's perspective. There are some duties that the government also has to do in terms of outreach and they don't look for any profit in this. It's a thing that they have to do and they will need to do. The government will need to do. In a village also, they will have to open a school. So I am not challenging what you are saying. The quality of Bal Vatika might not be equal to DPS. But I am saying that please understand if he or she is not getting anything, because DPS will not open in Charama. It will not open in a small place. But at least some basic education is there. That's the aim of the government. So we cannot compare.
Sir, I am not comparing. I am saying that how we will fill up the gap. What is the way out of it?
That's what I am saying.
Yeah.
The second important thing is the policy does not have, should not, in fact. The policy can set guidelines. It is the act that comes in. Because now this will go to the parliament. Both the parliaments will discuss and both the Lok Sabha and will discuss and an act. When the act comes, all these things will come in. Reading the policy, the 58-page policy, and inferring that we have not made a roadway is not fair. This is what I think, with due respect to what you have said. But in the higher education segment, there is a roadmap. And the roadmap is 2040. This policy takes us till 2040 and says that Merus are the way ahead. So IITs, any university that you take abroad, which is in the top 100, just take any university, you will say that they are multidisciplinary university, whether it is Harvard, Stanford, Princeton, you name them, they are multidisciplinary. Whereas IITs and IIMs are single course, either it is technology or management. So they have already addressed this and said that by 2040, all IITs, IIMs, and all institutions, all universities will be multidisciplinary universities. Because if I learn technology in IIT, then I don't learn how to apply technology to society, because there is no humanities. And that's the reason they have said MERUs, they have called it multidisciplinary education and research universities, should be there in place by 2040. There is a roadmap. So I think we'll rest it here, because the other speakers have to speak. Jayashree ma'am, since you've raised some valid inputs in what we've said. You've said that villages without electricity and some things like that. So are you looking at a solution, or are you just finding it problematic? Because villages were not there with electricity even till now. So how was the schooling system running?
Sir, I would like to draw your attention towards right now, the corona era which we have right now, and the online courses which are going on. No doubt, all the urban schools, especially the private run schools, have their online classes and it's going on. But what about those poor kids who are residing at the interiors of the state or the country? I said that it's not impossible. It is possible. When we can reach to Andaman and Nicobar Islands with 4G, why we can't reach on the mainland itself with some electricity? The political will has to be there. And with that will, definitely, that is why it cannot be. If we would have all these systems at its place, we would have started next academic session itself with this new education policy. We cannot stand it, because these are the roadblocks which we have. We require a robust digital infrastructure to start with this education, to implement this education policy. Because the government wants that the children should start with coding from class 6th onwards. Excellent thought process. But for coding, they require systems. They require internet. And internet will only happen once when there is electricity, and 24-hour electricity should be there. Then government feels that vocational education should be started. Nice, very nice. Vocational education will definitely bring out the talents, hidden talents in the children. We don't know at our home, if I ask my son to fix a tap, he cannot do it. I want a plumber. Why should I need a plumber? These are the basic things which we should know. If I have to fix the fuse, I don't know. I have to call an electrician for that. So these are the basic things which the children should know. But for training them in all these things, for those 10 bagless days, when as Chawla sir said, that the children will have a very fantastic time with their learners, with the teachers, whoever will be there. But for that, the government needs to have the basic infrastructure. I feel this is a challenge which is in front of the government, and the government needs to take care of it as soon as it's possible. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I'll again ask a small question here. How much have we as private schools succeeded in getting away with rote learning and getting in critical thinking into our children with all the bandwidth, all the internet and all the best things possible that we have?
Sir, it's a very difficult task, though I'm trying to do it, but it's very difficult. You know, course completion is the foremost thing to happen in life, in everybody's life, let it be teacher, am I audible, sir?
Yes. Carry on.
Yeah. I said it is rote learning can only happen, can only be stopped once with the cooperation with the parents. Parents should stop worrying about course completion. Syllabus completion is not the biggest task. It is, I don't understand why a child in class one has to be taught with addition, subtraction, multiplication and division, all the four aspects of maths. This is something which has to be spread up to class 5. Why do we have to teach them counting till 1000 when they don't know how to write up to 100? Why don't we focus on that? Why do we have to teach them that you learn the answers and vomit it on your answer sheets and get 100% marks? Why don't we find it important that reading is more important than writing or making designs on the answer sheets? I personally feel that these are not the ways to teach. The teaching should happen. Learning must take place. Child should know the concept learning. How many of us teach in school that what is zero? Do we start counting from zero? Why don't we start it from 0 to 5 and then 5 to 9? Do we tell them that 10 is 1 tens and 0 ones? No, we tell them 1 0 10. How the child is able to understand that the place value changes there. It's the most difficult part. We teach them 1 1 11. What 1 1 11? Are 1 1 both at the ones place, both at the tens place? What? If we teach them that 1 tens and 1 ones make 11, they will definitely remember that the place value changes. That is what I feel, that it should happen in this manner, and parents have to cooperate. Otherwise, principals will have a tough life as I am having.
Okay. Kiran Pal, sir.
Yes, sir.
Taking from where ma'am left, two things. One is, having said all that we have said, that critical thinking and all that, are our teachers equipped to do it?
Yes, sir. I'll take a few points from Ma'am Jayashree ma'am. What she rightly said, sir, there has to be an intention and action. Government has showed the intention in developing this whole policy. Now the action has to be taken. I'm happy, I'll come to your question. I'm happy that the ministry's name, HRD, has been changed to education. That's a very welcome move. But now that action has to be shown. I was listening somewhere in our discussion that Harvard University, please correct me if I'm wrong, you're a learned man, Dr. Jawahar sir, that Harvard University alone, the kind of budget that they have for education is like the whole country's budget in India. Is that so?
Yes, it is right.
So kindly this word to be heard to all the bureaucrats, if anybody is listening to this webinar today, that we need that kind of budgets first, and we need to stop those freebies. Only then we can actually lift the standard of education. And coming second to your point, sir, that see, teachers are, if they have taken as a career, I always say that there are two kind of people. There are teachers by choice and teachers by chance. So a lot of teachers are by chance. I'll share one thing. When we go for some kind of counseling in the rooms, and if I ask how many of you wish to be bureaucrats, there'll be certain hand. How many doctors, engineers, there'll again be certain hand. But when I ask how many of you would like to be teachers, to bade dabe sehme se do ek haath aayenge. And when we take interviews for teachers, somebody who has been scoring a 45%, 50%, second division, third division, he comes and sits in front of you and wants to be a teacher. So when good children are now, if they are being motivated enough to come into education and come into training, then certainly that level of education will change. We'll get good teachers. Right now, the issue is we are not getting good teachers because it has not been a very good attractive or alluring career. So we need to think on that also. And when good people come in, then certainly they are coachable. They have to be coachable enough.
Okay.
So that training part can certainly be addressed.
Yes. So, sir, the first point that you had made, Harvard, majority of its funds come from its alumni. So right. the government does not fund it to the extent that we think. But funds are required to run a high-level university, which is a fact. The second thing that you have said, sir, and I fully agree. Now, there are two things that two of you have raised. One is that parents need to be counseled. And second is you said that teachers should be passionate enough to be able to do this. Now, if both these things are taken into consideration, then are you saying that the parent and teachers are equal participants to anything that happens in this policy?
Certainly, sir. Obviously, the teachers and parents both have their roles to play, and more so teachers, because what happens is at home, the parents, the children listen more to their teachers than to their parents. To their parents, they take them for granted.
Yes, yes.
But if the teacher is saying, it's an age-old phenomena ki meri teacher ne agar aisa bola hai, toh aisa hi hai. Aap galat bol rahe ho, teacher sahi bol raha.
Ye hota hai.
तो ये चीजें सर कि वी बोथ हैव टू पार्टिसिपेट एक तरफ एज पेरेंट्स वी हैव टू हैव अ शिफ्ट ऑफ माइंडसेट दैट एजुकेशन इज नॉट ओनली नंबर्स एजुकेशन इज नॉट ओनली डिग्री एजुकेशन इज मच मच बियॉन्ड दैट एंड द टीचर्स आल्सो हैव टू कम अप विद न्यू इनोवेटिव वेज ऑफ टीचिंग आई अगेन वुड लाइक टू आंसर वन थिंग सर दैट एज यू आस्क्ड जयश्री मैम दैट हैव द स्कूल्स बीन एबल टू सक्सीड इन व्हाट इज एक्सपेक्टेड आउट ऑफ देम इफ दैट वाज योर क्वेश्चन To that, sir, I would say, if a little bit of freedom is given to schools, that you decide that what kind of syllabus would you like to teach, these things which are coming in NEP would have come long back. Would have come long back. आपने ये चीजें तो आप हमारे teachers से कहते हैं sir हमें बड़ा suffocated feel होता है because we are governed by this policies of CBSE कि हमें ऐसा ही पढ़ाना है, यही ही पढ़ाना है. I mean, you need to give us the freedom. ये तो common sense की बात है sir कि एक up to 8th class तक के बच्चे को क्या पढ़ाना चाहिए, up to 8 years तक के बच्चे को क्या पढ़ाना चाहिए. So that freedom is required, and thanks to NEP that we are coming up with that kind of very researched documents. That's really good.
Okay. So Mr. Ravi Gupta, if he is hearing, one thing that has come out at least positively here is that. This NEP has been discussed widely in the educational circles of higher education and school education. But has it been discussed and parents' views been taken on this? Is something that you will need to probably have a webinar on this for parents and understand their views and be told on what is available in NEP, what are their roles and responsibilities. It is not happening. So probably ELETS can be the platform where you can raise this. Having said that, again, Mr. Hota, let's take 2 minutes each and understand NEP, the pros and cons of NEP, because we've discussed at least, so maybe 2 pros and 2 cons each.
So one thing just I'm sharing actually,
okay.
What sir has told our Chawla sir, the same thing. It's my question that whenever we are talking about the educational development, it is education development. Earlier we are talking about the tripolar system. One is parent, another is the students, another is the teacher. Now we are calling it as a 4-polar systems, tetrapolar. So now we are talking that parents, teachers, then society and the skill development. That is also coming. And the students. Pentaponal. But now when we are talking about the holistic progress card, because education ultimately we have to evaluate in a scientifical temperament that we have seen within this report, progress card. And really I feel very much happy that the holistic progress card that will include self assessment, peer assessment, and teacher assessment. It is the excellency, but it's my again actually somewhere we are missing the parents assessment. It is also one of the point, because when we have taken training from NUPA under our UGC chairman, yes, he was in that time there chairman, he has told again and again, and it is required, but it is missing. Then also I am saying that whenever we are talking about 360 degree multidimensional report card has prepared, it's really pleasure mood for us. And another thing, the it should be globalization is also one of the great aspects. So there are the two points. One is the educational liberalization, another is the assessment and holistic progress card development. And third one is the equity and equality of the educational system for all.
Okay. Jayashree ma'am, your thoughts?
Yes, sir. I feel two things, sir. Students will become stress-free with this new education policy. They will have a wonderful examination time, less tutorials, and you know, a good life. And another thing, what the Prime Minister said, India will become a knowledge hub. I wait to see that. I will be more happy to see that. Again, the drawback, number one, the infrastructure, number two, trained teachers. These two will become a very, very crucial point to be taken care of. Thank you, sir.
So the NEP document has this, that by 2022, they will plan to train all teachers. So it's already mentioned here. Mr. Kiran Pal Singh Chawla, sir.
Yes, sir. What I say is, as Robin Sharma rightly says, that any change is resisted in the beginning, messy in the middle, but very good at the end. So this is what is going with the NEP also. It's being resisted at certain levels, and I'm sure that we have to be patient enough, because it's going to be messy in between, because a lot of things are not very clear. And final, the outcome, to my prayers, are that the children should be benefited and the final outcome should be, yes, good. Yes. So two, yes, pros that I find is that children will be benefited, will be able to develop global citizens through this education policy. And the true sense of education, like one thing is that multiple choice of subjects, that, yes, is something that I really like. I'll quickly quote a small example out of my own family. Sir, my son was studying commerce in his class 11th and 12th, and he had one additional subject called the psychology. And after 12th, he asked me, Dad, mera interest commerce mein itna nahi. I said, psychology acha lag raha hai? He said, yes. I said, very good. Go ahead and do a BA in psychology. Where is he now? He's studying psychology, sociology, and economics. So this was very much possible, that during class 11th, 12th, a child of 14 to 15 years is finding that what is my true interest. Otherwise, because I run coaching institutes also, I feel a lot of time children are trapped. Ab 11th, 12th mein tune maths liya to tujhe yahi karna, bio liya to tujhe yahi karna. So that myth will be like broken, that end will be broken, and it will be a very, very healthy move for the country. So my best wishes for this NEP, sir. And my final word is, thank you so much. You have moderated it so well. In fact, mujhe to aapko sunne ki jyada ichha ho rahi thi, hame bolne ki ichha kam ho rahi thi. And thank you so much to Dr. C.V. Raman University for giving me this opportunity. And thank you to ELETS team for arranging this lovely webinar.
Very, very warm thank you to all of you and the platform that they have given us. My last words would be that I wish to see NEP to the extent that I wish to see. But since education is in the concurrent list, and there is a lot of political intervention also in this, so the states will also have the chance to dilute it if they want it. Implementation is a challenge, but I think the will of the government at the center is so strong that I hope that it prevails, but also it listens to what are the cons that are there and listens to them openly and tries to sort them out before the act is formulated. This is my prayer. Thank you very much all, and ELETS.
Sir.
Namaskar, sir. Thank you, sir. One thing just I'm sharing. At the last...
questions in the Q&A. There are certain questions in the Q&A.
We'll take that, sir. 2 o'clock, there is another session lined up.
Sir, at the last, actually, I extend my gratitude and thanks to Shivaraman University, as well as other university of the country also, who are trying to facilitate in this way, as well as elite groups. My salutation to all of them. We have really wonders after this overwhelming sessions. And again, it's my request to the government to apply this policy in the right directions by which the whole nation will be upgraded.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Jayashree, ma'am, you wanted to say?
Thank you very much. It was really, really a proud moment to share that screen with you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Jawahar sir, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद आप आए सेशन में और we are honored to have you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, there are questions in the Q&A box. If we could answer that, हमारे जो guests जो हैं login जिन्होंने किए शायद उन्हें कुछ फायदा हो if we time permits.
Sir, इनको ना start कर लें दीजिए parallelly you can do it.
Yeah, like I mean. Yeah.
So let the session start. I think like we can do it later. Abhishek, if you can. Update.
Sir, we have the time. If you can give the, we have to 10 to 10 minutes time. If you want to cover the Q&A, we can do that.
Okay, because the audience is there.
Sir, you can take any question that you feel that you want to take.
Sir, this is this question that somebody has asked that Mr. Abhishek Kumar has asked. My question is that what is the planning in NEP 2020 for private teachers in different CBSE private and project schools? The teachers training will be the main focus of here, and as in the pre-panel somebody was saying ki agar aapke andar quality nahi hai to behtar hai technology aapko replace kar jaye to aur yahan par kisi ne comment mein bhi ye baat kahi likhi ki how can we make teaching aspirational, how can good students can aspire to be teachers. So for that the teachers training framework also has to be there in the NEP, and I think they have covered it very nicely that now since they will be upgrading the teachers also, so more and more people would be interested in becoming good teachers. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. So the 4-year B.Ed program, B.A. B.Ed and B.B.A. B.Ed and B.Com B.Ed and B.Sc. B.Ed is precisely meant for this. And they are wanting to strengthen it because teachers who aspire to be teachers, as Mr. Kiran Pal Singh has said, are less. So if somebody decides to become a career teacher, because the salaries now are getting better and better, both in the government sector and in the private sector.
Right.
And in the especially in the private sector, the better you are, the better you will be paid. There is no other option left. So your growth is totally dependent on your talent and your ability to serve to the students what they are supposed to be served. If it is tasty or not, whether they can digest it or not, it totally depends upon your this thing. Having said that, there is a framework which is being created by NCERT. Now, this framework looks at not just the subjective aspects, because I think CBSE has already put in 28 modules of teacher training already on its portal, which any of you teachers, if you want to, you can avail of it. I think it is charged at 100 rupees. Or maybe it's free. I think it's 100 rupees.
Diksha portal and Shiksha.
What we can do is that they are looking at a framework wherein critical thinking aspects and the holistic development aspects are to be integrated into the training, which is currently not happening. So this is something which is new to teachers. Though they are, it's in the pipeline. So this is something that is happening. We should also take a cue from international boards where the training and upgradation happens on a regular basis. So it's not a one-time thing. Every 2 years, a teacher is upgraded to the latest technologies and the latest happenings. Something like that is it, then our teachers will automatically get upgraded. And especially some of us in the government schools who teach in vernacular languages, they are not upgraded to the level the private school teachers are upgraded. So even a mediocre private teacher sometimes overtakes a very good government teacher. this is something that is, that usually happens because upgradation is happening. Like this needs to happen. Questions of higher education week, if we could take. My question is focus on technical PG programs. The technical PG program is here. That yes, the question I have is technical programs are of 4 years. The engineering, if you are talking of that, it's of 4 years. So the rest of the 3 year degree programs have become 4 years. Engineering remains the same. So it's PG programs of technical this thing remain the same. M.Tech is of 2 years. So there is no change in the PG of technical courses. A very clear indication that the government wants a 4 year degree program, except for they mentioned two, which is medicine and law. So these are the 2 5-year programs that they have. The rest are all 4 years now onwards when this is implemented. So that is about the higher education. Any other question, Mr. Chawla, that you are seeing? I think that's about it. It's time to close. Thank you very much, sir.
Namaskar, sir. Thanks for the gratitude, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Jawahar, sir, for a wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
Interactive session. And I think our audience has been overwhelmed regarding this technical advancement and in the education sector. Thank you, Jessie, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Satyaji, sir. Thank you, Karan Pal, sir.
Thank you
for joining.
Thank you very much.
And I request all the participants, you can follow all the social handles of our speakers as well. If you have any question, you can drop your question offline as well. So they can entertain you. And if you want to put, you can put the question at the education@digitallearning.in. We will well connect it to all the speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.